understand the dynamics of what God is about to do in your life. He's about to change your mindset. You're going to have a paradigm shift. You're going to have a change and a shift in the spirit where what was will not be again, and what will be greater than that which was. God wants you to know he's speaking to you today in a way that's going to penetrate not only your mind, but go right into your heart. The preaching and the teaching and the demonstration of God's word here will not only prove to the fact that God is alive, but it will show the devil that he is defeated. And we are here today as a unified body under the Lord Jesus Christ, and we are here to declare the word of God. I want to want this one word to come and be prominent throughout this service, and I want you to get this word. It might be a new word to you. Maybe it's not. That's okay. This is what we're all about right here. It's the word restive. Everybody say restive right now. Say it real loud. Restive. And the definition of that is a person who becomes unable to keep still or silent and becomes increasingly difficult to control, especially because of impatience, dissatisfaction when he or she sees wrong is being done to them. Everybody say restive. Now, Father God, we thank you for this service. We thank you for the word of God. We ask you to let it penetrate as they think through this service. Help this mindset to be placed inside of them so that no matter what comes their way, be hell or high water, that they will overcome and become a restive spirit, Lord God, that they will get up on the inside and change that which is on the outside. We thank you for it now in the wonderful name of Jesus. And everyone agreed and said with me, amen. Now, as we study the subject, I want this to position yourself so that you will begin to experience major turnarounds in your life. And then also that you are able to experience the restoration that God's word provides for you. You see, we need to be people of the word, people of the spirit, people are serving him with all of our heart. And God is about to do something very fantastic and a change in your life. Now, we've discovered in our last two messages from Deuteronomy chapter 30 that God promises that he will turn the captivity of your situation around for the good. We found our text in Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 2, 3, 9, and 10. And let's read as followed. And it says, "And return to the Lord your God and obey his voice according to all that I command you." Listen, always present this day. You and your children, not only you, but you need to teach your children, say amen, with all your heart, not some, and with all your soul, that then the Lord your God will turn your captivity and have compassion upon you. Then verse 9 promises, "And the Lord your God will prosper you abundantly in every work of your hand." Not some, every work of your hand. Here's what he says. If you listen to the voice of God, that means listen doesn't only mean that you hear it. You not only hear it, but you now put it into practice and do it. And he says, if you listen to the voice of the Lord your God to keep his commandments. Now, as you can see, that God promises that he will stop the attack as you, by faith and prayer, activate this promise, and you make the enemy then restore back to you everything he has stolen as you have gone through that problem. Can you say praise God for that? Now, I want us to go to Genesis chapter 27 in a minute. But before I do, let me just say this emphatically. That means very powerfully. Nothing in your life changes until you get fed up with your current circumstance. Nothing. Absolutely nothing. You're going to stay the same old stinking way if you don't get fed up with your situation. It means that you have reached a place that you are not going to take it anymore. You're not going to stay this way. That's what fed up means. When I was a young child, I had a wonderful dad. His name was Salvatore Giovanni Pellinetto. Hallelujah. That was my dad. They call him Sal. And so we need to understand he was a powerful guy. Wonderful father. Good provider. But he didn't mess around. Not at all. When he told you to do something, he would come up to me sometimes, and I'm sure Rosemary can verify this, and she was a much better child than I was at that time. I was not as good as she was. Amen. Dad used to come to me, he says, "I want you to do this, that, there, and the other." And like a good child, I say, "Okay," and then I wouldn't do it. Then later on, all of a sudden, a powerful anointing would come on my father with a powerful right hand of correction. Anybody know what I'm talking about here? Hallelujah. And he would get fed up with me, and then I would either get up or else. Amen. I think that spirit needs to come into the church again and come into the family of God again. We need to get fed up with the devil. I said, we need to get fed up with the devil. A lot of Christians just tolerate the enemy or the situation they're going through and thinking they can't do anything. But I want to pronounce to you in a real powerful way, you can do something about it. Now in Genesis 27, we find this story of where Isaac is now old. Matter of fact, he's ready to go home to be with the Lord. And it's that time where he is now to pass the blessing down to his oldest child. Esau and Jacob are his child. And Esau, being the oldest, was entitled to that blessing. Now, as you remember, how many know the story here? As you remember how Jacob had deceived his father into making him think that Isaac was thinking he was that person, was Esau. And he actually deceived him to transfer the blessing to him. Now when Esau found out about this and realized that his brother had deceived his father, he then received the covenantal blessing. He goes and he says these words in Genesis chapter 27 verses 34 and following. Here's what he said after this problem. And you need to understand what's taking place here. When Esau heard the words of his father, listen what it says. He cried with an exceedingly great and bitter cry. This guy boohooed. He was boohooing. Tears were flowing out of his eyes. He was really upset. He was anguished. He was really in a state of mind where he didn't know what to do. And he said to his father, "Bless me. Bless me also, oh my father." And he said, "Your brother," this is Isaac, "your brother came with deceit and has taken away your blessing." Don't you get mad when the blessings are taken away? Say amen. Hallelujah. And then verse 38 goes on. Esau asked, Do you only have one blessing, father? Bless me too. Bless me too. I got ripped off here. Father, Esau sobbed loudly. And it goes on, his father Isaac answered, "The place where you live will lack the fertile ground." In other words, it's going to be hard to farm, bro. How many know sometimes it's just hard to farm the land? I mean, you can go out and try to do this, that, and the other, and it's always one problem after another. And then he goes on and says, not only that, but the dew from the sky above, that won't even help. And then he says in verse 40, something that you need to hear here today that's so profound and so good that we understand. He says, you will use your sword. That's going to be a hard life. And you will serve your brother. But here's the thing you need to do. But eventually, everybody say eventually. Say it again. Eventually. Here's what's going to happen. You will gain your freedom and break his yoke from off your neck. I don't know about you, but anybody have a pain in the neck in their life someplace? Hallelujah. I know we have some. We all have some from time to time. Hallelujah. Maybe you are a pain in the neck. Amen. And you're in this situation like this. Well, let me just tell you, when you read the Amplified version of the Bible, of this text, it tells you when this will occur, when Esau would gain his freedom. And Isaiah tells us here in the book, in the Amplified Bible, in verse 40, it says, when you grow restless with the situation, then you will have it. In other words, in North Carolina talk, it means he got fed up. Say amen. He just got fed up with the situation. He was not happy with the words. He was not happy with the situation. He did a stupid thing. He did something. Did you know, even before that, it tells us what happened here, that he even sold his birthright for a bowl of stew to Jacob. He did a stupid thing. Anybody ever do stupid things here? Come on, raise your hand and say, "Yeah, I'm one of those people who have done stupid things and have to pay for it then." Let me just tell you, you're in a good situation right now to hear the answer for your stupidity. Say amen. Amen. Hallelujah. And I don't say that in a negative way. I'm saying that we all have problems and we all need God's help. Can you say amen? Amen. Now, in other words, Esau, you're going to stay this way the rest of your life until you get to the point that you become restive on the inside, that you become restless with the situation, that you become fed up with the situation, until you get on the inside something that's going to change something on the outside. Come on now, that's good preaching. So when Esau would come to that realization and he would begin to exercise his authority, that's when the turning of the captivity would take place. But he had to be fed up. Otherwise, he was going to stay this way the rest of his life. How many have people that they know that are just staying the same way, and it looks like they're going to stay this way the rest of their life? Listen, if you're going to overcome your problem, you're going to have to get fed up with it, with situations, and start getting up to what God wants you to do. Hallelujah. This is what I'm saying to you here today. This is what the Spirit of God is saying to you here today. Are you just going to sit there? Are you just going to sit down and let, listen, the devil take our country, and let the devil take your life, and let the devil touch your family, touch your career, touch this church, and you do nothing about it? Let me just tell you, I used to have a doctor when I used to live in Cleveland, Tennessee. I was going to Lee College at the time. And we used to go to this doctor, and he was a funny doctor. He would talk like this. He would, how you doing, like that. And we would get, he would come, and he would diagnose the problem. Then he would look at us and say to us, "What are you going to do about it?" I would say to myself, "Well, you're the doctor. You do something about it." But you know what? Until you start doing something about your own life, nothing's going to change in that way. You need to learn how to get up, get on, and go what God has for you. Hallelujah. So here's what you need to do. When you become restive on the inside, meaning you have discovered from the Word of God what it says and the promises of the Word of God, that you start changing the way you talk, that you're no longer talking the problem, but you're talking the answer from God's Word, then you get the answer, and with the help of the Holy Spirit, you start doing what you can't do in the natural by the power of the Spirit and the Word of God. Then, all of a sudden, God begins to change the atmosphere around you, and the situation begins to churn and yearn to what was now negative, now becomes positive. What became bad now becomes good. Are you hearing me today? God wants to turn your captivity around. And I want you to know right now, I want you to know, you can just live and exist, or you can live it out to the abundant life. I don't know about you, but I'm sick and tired of being that way. I don't want to merely exist. I want to have the what God says. How many want what God says for your life? Hallelujah. Now, you happen to be in a church right now. How many know that you're in a good church? Thank God for the other churches in town, but I don't know about as much about them as I do here. And I want you to know, this is a church that believes all the promises of God, and that you, as a believer of God, are in covenant with Him, and you have rights and privileges as children of God. I want you to know that you are the head and not the tail. You are above only and not beneath, that you can live and turn your situations around right now. How many need to turn around in your life right now? Let me see your hands. God wants to do that. And I want you to know that's important that you understand what God wants you to do. Now listen, what I'm saying to you is you have to become restive, restless on the inside. You got to get fed up. If you don't get fed up with the situation, meaning if you don't become determined to do something about it, it will stay that way until you get off your duffy and start getting up and doing something about your situation. And God says, when you start to go, I go with you. When you start to speak my word, then my power will come out of you. When you start to depend on the Spirit, then your flesh will subside and your spirit will increase, and all things are possible to him that believes. So God wants you to know right now that we are on the good thing right here. We are on the positive side of what God wants you to do. But what you need to do is get in the Word of God. Some of you have not spent time in the Word this week. Maybe this is the only time you got. Thank God you're here. But you have to spend time in the Word of God on a daily basis in your life. Let me just tell you something. God's plan, once it's found out, is not like my plan. And it's certainly not like the devil's plan. And over time, as you begin to feed your spirit as you begin to change your mind to line up with the Word of God, as you begin to speak out what God's Word says, as you begin to rely on the Spirit of God to do what you can't do from the Word, and by faith do it in the power of the Spirit, then all of a sudden, things begin to change. Things begin to turn. The situation is about to turn around, but you got to get restive. Say it again. Restive in the name of Jesus. Now, people who are fed up and passive are not going to stay that way. They're people of action. They're people that do something about it. You remember Paul in the New Testament? He was in a town. I don't forget which town it was offhand. But this one lady who had the spirit of divination was following him. And she had an evil spirit in him. She would taste stuff like, these people are the children of the Most High God. These people are the children of the Most High God. She would follow Paul all around and say, these children are the children of the Most High God. Eventually, the Spirit of God rose up in Paul where he got aggressive and he got also restless in his spirit, where he turned around and looked at the Spirit and command the Spirit to go. Let me just tell you something. You got to get fed up with the devil. The Bible says in the Word of God in Matthew chapter 11, verse 12, the kingdom of God suffers violence, listen, and the violent take it by force. You don't just sit there. I remember Smith Wigglesworth. Anybody hear of Smith Wigglesworth? I remember he was at a street corner one day, waiting on a bus, and this one lady walked with her dog. And a little dog was bothering her. And it was not her dog. And she was saying to the dog, shoo, 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 little doggy, shoo. And he got really upset. He said, that's not the way you do it. He said, dog, go. And that dog took off. Sometimes we get so passive that we let people walk on us, especially the devil, when you can do something about your situation. Amen. You don't have to let it be that way. You know, I was sitting the other day outside, my wife and I, and we were sitting having a nice steak, which I cooked on the grill. Can you smell it now? Say amen. Hallelujah. With corn and mashed potatoes. Say amen. You can't get better than that. Say amen. And all of a sudden, the little flies came around. How many know what I'm talking about? We just say, shoo, fly. Get out of here. We need to do that with the devil. We don't need to allow him to bombard our minds with the attack that he gives. We need to give the devil what he deserves. The authority of the Word of God coming out of our mouth and faith believing the Word of God. Hallelujah. And we need to get out and do what God says. You need to get fed up with what God says. So here's what you need to do. You need to get fed up, get up, prayed up, faith up, look up, and step up so you can get what God has for you. Hallelujah. Can you say amen? Now, this principle is seen throughout the Bible. It is a principle that you don't have to take what the devil gives you. You don't have to put up with the situation as it is. I'm not saying you won't have situations. I'm just saying you don't have to put up with the way for it to remain that way. You know, we are not in denial. We are denying that thing to stay the way it is, though. We want it changed by the Word of God. Now, in the book of Mark, we find this woman who had an issue of blood. You remember the story? She had suffered many, many years and spent everything she had, but she didn't get any better. She probably spent thousands and thousands of dollars, maybe even tens and hundreds of thousands of dollars. We don't know, but we know this. She spent all she had. That's enough. Say amen. And she said she lived with this illness for 12 stinking long years. 12 years. It is 2017. That means 2019. In 2029, you finally come around. That's a long time to put up with a problem. And here it is. One day she heard that Jesus was coming to town. Aren't you thank God that Jesus is here today? Hallelujah. And she heard that he had performed miracles. So she started to believe. And she started to trust God that maybe that miracle can happen for me. Say, maybe that miracle will happen for me here today. And even though she was sick and could hardly walk, she made her way to Jesus. She was determined she wasn't going to stay this way anymore. I'm not going to do this anymore. I am fed up the way my life is going, I know I'm better than this. I'm better than this. I don't deserve this. I'm not going to stay down. I'm tired of paying doctor bills. I'm tired of being looked at and being shunned. I'm tired of being put down. I've had it. I'm fed up. Hallelujah. Now, in Mark chapter 5, verse 28, it says this. She finally came to this conclusion. If I can may touch his clothes, I'll be made whole. Now, she believed so much that she made it her objective that whatever was in the way was not going to stand. She went through this crowd. The Bible teaches us that she pressed through. She didn't just walk through. She said, excuse me, get out of my way. Get out of my way. I'm going to touch him. Get out of my way. I'm sneaking up. I'm going to touch him. And she pressed through. Not only that, she was a woman. Not only that, she had an illness that was not regarded as good and not allowed in that community at that time. She went against all odds. And she pressed through. Finally, she touches him. And all of a sudden, just as she's... What happened to that woman? She got restive. She got restless on the inside. When you get restless on the inside with the Word of God, soon something's going to happen on the outside. Amen. And she began to say that, and she said that. She says, the actual tense of the verb means she kept on saying. Some of you are giving up on your confession. You're starting to speak negative after a while. Well, it's not happening as quick as I like. Well, tough. Amen. It's not your time, it's God's time. Say amen. God might be testing you to see how faithful you really are. He's not trying to hold back the blessing. He's wanting to see where your heart is. Are you only serving him because of what you can get out of him or because you really love him? If you love me, keep my commandments. And that means speak the word of God whether you feel like it or not, whether you want to or not, whether you're in a situation you like or not. You're going to be faithful because you love God. Come on, I need a bigger amen than that. Hallelujah. And so we need to understand this. And she finally touched him, and the healing power of God came through and healed her of that illness. Not only that, here's another story about this. There's blind Bartimaeus. What a guy. He's blind. He couldn't see. I don't know about you. I know a few people. I used to help one of my friends in seminary who was blind. I used to read for him. He was a funny guy, too. We had fun, a lot of fun together as far as working in the Lord. And he couldn't see at all. And he was blind. He was in a mining accident, and it blew out both of his eyes. He didn't have any eyes. He didn't have any eyeballs. Okay? All he had was things you put in there, and that's it. Used to lead him around. How many know today he's a PhD? Hallelujah. I think he works out of Fuller. Thank you, Jesus. Don't let obstacles stop you. Don't let situations put you down. Turn it around for the good. Say amen. Make your scar turn into a star for Jesus. Make your problem become a solution with the power of God. And here was this blind Bartimaeus. And here he was, and he heard that Jesus is coming. All of a sudden, this guy outrageously starts to cry out. He starts to cry out, Jesus! He shouted. Are you afraid to hear me shout? Some of you might think that's embarrassing. He shouted out, Jesus, Son of God, have mercy on me. Real loud, not soft, like, hey, Jesus, have Son of God, have mercy on me. He wasn't like that. He was very aggressive. He was very desperate. He was very restive. On the inside, something began to churn. Something began to yearn. Something said to him, you don't have to stay this way any longer. You can do something about your situation, your circumstance, your problem, your life, your church, your business, your career, everything that you have. You can change it around, but you got to get fed up. You got to get festive. You got to get restless. And here he is. Jesus! He shouted more. People would say, shh, we're in church. We don't do that here. We can do it at the football game. We can do it at the baseball game. We can do it out on the beach, but don't do it here. They'll think you're a fanatic. Any fanatics for Jesus here today? I said, any fanatics for Jesus? If you are a fan for him, why don't you stand up and give him an applause here today? Come on. Let's be a fan for him. Let's get on fire for him. Let's do what God says right now. Let's lift up our hands and praise him with all of our heart. Let's go to town with Jesus and let him be Lord of all. Come on, shout amen. Shout unto the Lord with a voice of triumph. Shout unto the Lord with a voice of praise. Hallelujah. Amen. That's good. He just got louder. He just got louder. You know, the devil can't stand when you praise him. Mark, that was an awesome word. Hallelujah. You know what it says? Out of the mouth of babes and suckling, thou hast ordained praise that may silence the enemy and the avenger. It silenced the mouth of the enemy. Say, shut your mouth, devil. All you're going to do is lift up holy hands, one without wrath, the other without doubt, and praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Okay, come on, devil. You want to hang out? I'm going to praise him while you're here. I'm going to worship God. You know, the devil will not stay while you are praising God. He doesn't like the atmosphere. Some of you right now are kind of wondering about the atmosphere you're in right now because it's not normal to you. That's okay. It's a holy normal. Say amen. It's a holy place. You're walking on a holy ground. You might have to take off your shoes in a minute, and we hope that you took a bath too. Say amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's John. That wasn't the Holy Spirit. Say amen. Praise God. All of a sudden, he got louder and louder and louder. And I want you to see something as he got louder. Mark chapter 10, verse 49, the beginning. And Jesus stood still. Like this. Here comes Jesus. And all of a sudden, blind Bartimaeus, he's starting to scream. What did he scream? And he stood still. He got the attention of Jesus. He got the word of the Lord. Jesus stood still. Do you understand what that means? Do you understand the power that are in those words right there? The power where God Almighty in the flesh stands still for you. And then he commands him, get that boy and bring him over here. Get him and bring him here. I want to talk with him. How many know that God wants to talk with you here today? God wants to minister to you. God not only wants to talk with you and minister to you, God wants to turn your captivity around for the good. Glory to God. God, glory to God. God wants to bring it all back in the name of Jesus. What happened to this dude? He got really restive. Let me just tell you something. He continued and yelled all the louder and all the louder, and then Jesus touched him. If you got the attention of Jesus, I'd say that's passing a good test. Amen. I want you to notice something, though, that Bartimaeus did. It's found in verse 50. This is powerful. I want you to see it, though. Say it with me. And he, casting away his garment, rose and came to Jesus. I want you to know what those garments were. They were beggar garments. That was his business. You had to get certified by the city to do that. You had to get certified so you can sit down and legally beg beggar clothes. This is my uniform. This is what I do for a living. So I sit around and I ask to collect. And so what he did, he started to change his mind. He had a poverty mindset, a mindset that says, this is all I can have. This is all I can do. This is all I'm worth. I'm only worth $1,000, $2,000, or whatever they give me a month. And I'm going to stay there. No, 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 no. He changed his mindset from a poverty mindset to a greater than he mindset. a mindset that says, I can do all things through, I'm better than this. Doggone it. I'm better than this collection. I'm better than what I've been. I'm tired of sitting on the corner begging all the rest of my life. Are you tired of that? Not only that, he also cast it off. Here's why. So it would not in any way impede or slow down his journey to Jesus. So here's what I want to ask you. What thinking do you have? What things are you holding on to that is holding you back from what God has for you? What is it that you are? Maybe it's religion. Maybe you're afraid to get a little emotional in church like this. That's okay. I don't care what you get it, whether it's emotional or not emotional, just so you get up and get it. You might be introverted or extroverted. It doesn't matter to me. I happen to be both. Say amen. Hallelujah. I'm an ambidextrous guy in that way. Say amen. Hallelujah. We need to understand what God's saying here. We need to understand what's holding you back. What thinking have you held on to? The thinking that's not of God is called a lie. Back in the garden, we hear the words of Satan says, hath God said? Hath God said? So the devil always wants to bring questions to your mind. Listen, if you start questioning the word of God, it's a good sign that the word of God is what you need to follow. Instead of what you think, go with what God thinks. Amen. And I believe what it's important to tell you right now, that as we look at this, we need to look at our life and understand that as we change on the inside, eventually, say eventually, everything on the outside will change for the good. And I believe you need to lift up your hands one more time and say, thank you, Jesus, for turning my life around right now. Hallelujah. You know, when you go through that, I don't know what it is. Some of you are here. You might be going through something right now. I'm sure you are. If you're not going through something, then guess what? You're already dead. Because if you're not hitting the devil head on, you must be walking with him. You're going to have opposition. But guess what? I love this word. Here's what Jeremiah tells us. Read it with me loud. Behold, I am the Lord, the God of all flesh. Is there anything too hard for me? You know what the answer to that question is? No. No. There's nothing too hard for God. Matter of fact, I love this. One of the names of God in the Old Testament is El Shaddai. El Shaddai in the original Hebrew means this. The God in whom nothing is impossible. Say this. The God in whom nothing is impossible. That's El Shaddai. So when you come across the problem, it's no problem for El Shaddai. And when another problem comes your way, all you got to say out and turn to the devil and say, looks like another job for El Shaddai. Hallelujah. The God of the impossible. And I want to close with this word, so I want you to get ready, guys. In Psalm 126, I love this scripture. In verses 1 through 3, it says, when the Lord brought back the captivity of Zion. Listen to what their attitude was. We're like those who dream. This is so awesome. This is so wonderful. And then it says, then our mouth was filled with what? Laughter. This is so good. Have you ever gotten away by yourself and all of a sudden things start to turn around and you get the holy jiggles inside of you? And you begin to laugh in the spirit and you just begin to have a good old time. I pray for the spirit of joy to fall in this place this morning. And our tongue was filled with singing. Then they said among the nation, the Lord has done great things for them. Then look what it says. The Lord, say it with me, verse 3. The Lord has done great things for us, and we are glad. I want you to notice something. The most important word in these first three scriptures is the word when. It didn't say if. It said, say it again. When. The psalmist is saying this to you and I. By the Holy Spirit, I know he will. It's just a matter of time. guess what? The devil might have hit you with his hardest blow here today, but you're still standing. You're not knocked out. You still believe. There's a yearning in your heart for more. And God is talking to you right now. Keep standing. Keep standing. Satan, listen to this word. If Satan can't deceive you, then he can't defeat you. If Satan can't deceive you, he can't deceive you. Amen. He can't defeat you either. The only thing that you have to know in this is the word of God. And you shall know the truth. And the truth acted on will set you free. Listen, that devil cannot defeat you. He cannot in any way deceive you if you know the truth. That's why God's here today. God's here telling you that there's more. You don't have to stay in this situation. You don't have to stay in this. You can overcome life's problems. Matter of fact, my covenant is for you. My redemption is for you. My blessings are for you. My turnaround is for you. My word is for you. I am for, if God be for us, who, what, where, when can be against us? God is here. Are you restless on the inside? How many are feeling that restlessness in their heart? Here's the question then. What are you going to do about it? It's not my life. I know what I'm going to do. It's yours. I stood beside someone yesterday and said, what are you going to do about it? Are you going to let the devil push you around? Are you going to let the devil keep on doing this to you? You know, you can't stop. One thing about the truth is when you have the truth, you stay with it. You keep on coming to church. You keep on praising God. You know, I just lost Mom. Mom's in heaven. She's better off than we are. We didn't actually lose her. We thank God we're going to see her again. When I lost my first wife to leukemia, man, that was the worst thing. Worse than my mom. My mom lived a full life. 95 years. Thank God I want to go that way. Say amen. My first wife was 33. Died with leukemia. At that time, I filled myself up with the whole word of God. Never missed a service. You can ask my trustees. Never missed. I'm not trying to brag. I'm just saying that's how you stay with it. And God turned it all around. Matter of fact, let me end with this story. I started to, after a while, I think after a year, I started to date Jan, that beautiful lady right there. Matter of fact, this past week was our 21st anniversary. Say amen.
Yeah.
21 years she put up with me. Hallelujah. But I'll never forget this story. My wife, first wife, died on December 23rd, 1991. Started to date Jan, and finally, after 7 years, we got married. We got married in 96, but 7 years to the day, Victoria came. Victoria came on December 24th at 4:13 in the morning. And God, the Holy Spirit, spoke to me. He said, you can do all things through me, John. You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. And at 4:13, that was the scripture of Philippians 4:13. He says, I want you to name this child Victoria. Victoria. Because now you have not only been victorious in the battle, but now through the battle. Come on, people of God. And that child right there stands as a testimony that God can turn it around and give you back all that you got stolen and more, though. I believe that God is in the house and that God wants to restore to you everything that has been stolen. I want you to stand up right now and praise Him for a minute. Thank you, Jesus. Man, this has been good today. Thank you, Jesus. I want you to bow your heads. I don't want you to be ashamed. I'm going to say, Pastor John, I need a miracle in my life. I want a turnaround right now. I don't know where you are, I don't know what it is. It doesn't matter. Wherever you are, that's what is important. And God wants to turn your life around. It's time to step up and let God take control of your life. If that's you and you need that touch and you're ready to get sick and tired of being where you are, I want you to lift your hands right now all over this place. Right now. Right now. That's right. That's right. That's right. That's right. Step out and step into this place. I want some people around this people right now. Come on up out of your seat. Bishop, come on up. John, if you're here and you need that miracle, step out of your seat right now. Come on. Come on. That's it. Come on up. Get with some of these people. They might need a miracle. They might need something. I want you to get with them. I want you in the congregation just to worship the Lord for a minute. Begin to lift your hands and thank God. Some of you, God is going to restore the joy. Restore what has been stolen. God is restoring to you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, lift your hands all over. Begin to worship Him in the congregation. Thank you, Jesus. 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 Lord, I speak blessings over their life.
Overflow in this place, presence of God, presence of God. We open ourselves up to you, presence of God, hey, presence of God, presence of God. Oh.